tonight we have somebody that's been here before, but has never done this before. So you've seen her work, maybe you haven't, but you're in for a treat because she's a world traveler. All her paintings will have a story, I'm sure of it, and she'll tell each and every one. Her name is Kathy Wayman, and here she is.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So terrific. Okay, well, I did belong to wet paints back, I think it was in the late 69, somewhere around there, 70s, and it was Helen Rundell that got me to come in. I knew nothing about art. I went to parochial school and never had art, knew nothing. And then when my fourth daughter was born, I almost died, I had to stay in the house for a long time. And when I was finally let out, everything looked so beautiful. I went to they used to have a gift shop in the middle of Sayville, and I had to buy a wedding present. I went in there, and I looked at all the silver and glass and started crying. And the man says to me, what's the matter? And I said, it's so beautiful. And I went home and started painting for the first time. And then I signed up at Sayville Adult Ed, and that was very good. But I didn't even know how to hold the pencil. It was very... No, I didn't. I didn't know anything. And it always felt, even now, I feel sort of inadequate because I didn't have that background. I didn't have any beginning, you know? And then my kids were going to St. Lawrence's School, and they asked me to come and teach art. And I didn't know how to do that. So I had to teach 200 kids on Friday, 50, 50, 50, and 50. So I would go to the library and study all week and figure out how to be a art teacher, you know. And it was very hectic, with 200 kids in one day. I used to come home so tired. I said, don't anybody touch me. And I couldn't even cook. I couldn't do anything. But so anyway, wet paints at that time, we met at Port of Call. That's down where wet pants meets. I don't know if they're still there, the sailboat group down by Port of Call. That's where we met, and Helen Rundell pressured the town to give us a press because she wanted to do printmaking, so the town got us a press. And I will pass this around. You can see we did dry point press, dry point etching. You do it on an aluminum plate and scratch, 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 and then ink it, and then clean it off, run it through the press, and you can make quite a few prints from that. So go ahead and pass that around. From Old West Paints Day, do any of you remember this lady?
Oh,
her name is Emma DeBottom. No, Muriel Christensen.
Muriel, yes.
Yeah, her husband was the ambassador from Norway, and they met at the UN, and she lived on my block, and she was just wonderful. Yeah, and she passed away only about 5 years ago. She has corn silk blue eyes. She was just wonderful, wonderful lady.
That's a beautiful sketch.
Yeah, yeah,
she moved to Amityville and to a senior place eventually. And I should also mention that I belong to South Bay Art Association. Members here tonight. And the National League of American Pen Women and Brookhaven Arts and Humanities.
Right.
Recently I was...
Nobody's thrown you out of them yet, right?
Pardon me?
Nobody's thrown you out of those clubs yet.
No, not yet. We're not putting it out here. Just recently, I was feeling kind of blue one evening because I didn't think I was going to see my family for Christmas, but it turned out I did. And
there you are.
I pick up this magazine that came in the fall and look at it, and there's me.
Wow.
Nice.
Yeah, so I left a couple copies over there if anybody wants one.
Nice.
This was from the library show, the Blue Point Library.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So nice. That was a pleasant surprise.
Yeah.
And also, I went to Stony Brook University and... first I went to Suffolk County Community College. I'm looking for an etching that I did there, can't seem to find it right now. Suffolk County Community College took everything they had until they threw me out, right? Then I went to Stony Brook University. I was a little timid about going there because it's a, not a friendly atmosphere. And, but I heard that this Professor County was very nice, so I went and signed up with Professor County, and that's how I got in the door. And I ended up loving it. I stayed there as long as I possibly could. I worked on getting a master's only because I wanted to use their press. I love bronze casting. they have a foundry. And yes, you could do your own bronze casting. And I just loved it. I loved it. Everything worked out beautifully. And they gave me many big shows while I was there. My first show was in the library, and I named it Portraits and Prophecies. And I had a whole lot of ones on wars and rumors, wars, nation, shall rise against nation, and Matthew 24, Luke 21. And this fellow comes in the door, and he's fainting, dark-haired fellow. And I went and grabbed him. I said, what's the matter? He says, oh, somebody tell me what's going on in the world. His name was Bilal, and he was from Lebanon. And with all the turmoil and civil war and everything that was going on there. So he introduced me to all these other guys, and we got to be very, very close friends. They have a custom that they get together with the mother in the late afternoon and talk. And they always said, we have psychiatrists because we have friends, and they're very friendly with each other. And they do. So they allowed me to be their surrogate mother for a while. And that's how I met these guys. And so anyway, on the Wars and Rumors of Wars, Nation Show, Rise Against Nation, I painted him as the Antichrist. And he says, don't tell me my mother. He's a Christian Palestinian from Jordan. Jordan has 80% Palestinians who did live in Israel. He had come from Bethlehem originally. And he won a prize for olive wood carving. And so anyway, so I changed the name to Ha'apikoros. That doesn't quite sound so bad when I hung it in Stony Brook. And this fellow's name is Iman, and he's a Maronite Christian from Beirut. And he posed for the head, and then he didn't come back. So he said to his friends, what happened to Iman? And they said, he's very sad. I said, well, what's he sad about? I don't know if you remember the massacres at Shabra and Shatila refugee camps that they blamed on Ariel Sharon, who was in the Israeli army. It was his family that did it. They were a Christian phalange, Christian militia, but they did it on Sharon's watch. So the whole press, oh, they just vilified Ariel Sharon, something terrible over that. You know, it was awful. But it was his family, so that he never came back. So then they got my son-in-law to for the chest and shoulders, and he didn't come back. So that's my hand down there. I looked in the mirror. So it's a composite of
why the Russian tank?
Russian? I don't know. What I did was I went around to armories, and I went to surplus stores to do gas masks and everything. And I didn't know it was Russian. Is it a Russian tank?
Well, looks like a Heimer sickle right there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. That's what. Okay, you reminded me. Ezekiel 38 war. That's what it is, about when Russia and the countries come down against Israel.
Yeah. Okay.
And it says fire. I put the fire up there. And you know what happened when I came home that day? There was a fire on one side of Nichols Road, and it blew right over in front of me. Would you believe it? It stopped before it got to the other side of the road, but it was just, what's that? I said, my goodness, what's going on here? Oh, yeah. And when I was at Stony Brook, I wanted to take monoprints. I wanted to take printing, because Dan Weldon is the printing teacher, and he's wonderful, and they have this wonderful press. which, you know, is hard to come by. So this is one of the many, 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 many. And that's from Revelation 16:13. I saw three unclean spirits like frogs. That's my frogs coming out of the mouths of the dragon, etc. So that's who those guys are. But, and it also says that angels will be loosed from the Euphrates, and we're seeing that now with all the trouble that's going on in the Euphrates area with Iraq and Syria. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
All this.
Now, how long ago was that?
This? All yes. these? I did these around late 80s.
That's when you did this?
Yeah.
Okay, that's amazing.
No, I did these all before this stuff started.
Yeah, I know, but it's just
yeah.
like.
Everything's happening now. Yeah, people are starting to get interested now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have one over in the Congregational Church of the sun is dark and the moon turns to blood and the stars fall from the sky. That's over in the Congregational Church. And then I had another one over in the Congregational Church I wanted to bring here, and I
you
forgot it was over there, of the synagogue in Budapest. With
the 30th is the reception, so we can see it.
Oh, the 30th.
Oh, okay.
January.
And when we went to Budapest, okay, so I better tell you why we went to these nations. I was with a group called Progressive Vision, and our vision was to go to the synagogues in Russia, Romania, Hungary, India, and China to speak to Jewish people about making Aliyah, immigration to Israel. And it's a good thing they did. Over a million Russians came in, and the Chinese went, and Indians were going too, but American Jewish people are not coming. You know, God said He's going to gather them from all the nations. Mm-hmm. So, and that was our mission in going there. And let me see, what was I going to say? Oh, and this was, oh, so anyway, yeah, they, so anyway, then I, when we saw this synagogue, and they said, that hundreds of thousands of Jewish people were taken away from there and never seen again to Auschwitz and wherever. And then my friends, girlfriends, and I walked across the city to the Budapest Museum, and it was all Christian art. And it just hit me in the gut, like, we were the Christians. You know, and that's why I wrote this poem about the sign of witness of the trees. Maybe I'll read it to you quickly. Tree-lined streets, now silent. Elms, a quiet witness. Mute, they cannot tell of that day like hell. God's chosen, selected for death. Seized, affrighted, families torn apart. Yellow stars condemned to cattle cars. Camps, gas, smell of death, as ashes fly. No, no, how could this be in a Catholic country, Hungary? Thousands upon thousands of men, women, and children dead? Only a few survived. Where were the Christians? Where was the church? The Jewish Savior mocked and scourged in his own people. He stood silently weeping in their midst. But where are those called by his name on this terrible night? A few bright stars, a few bright yellow stars lighted the sky that night. A few, the remnant, stood opposed to German might. Now their trees, trees of righteousness, stand straight and tall in silent honor on the avenue of righteous Gentiles. At Yad Vashem, Jerusalem. And we had a reconciliation meeting with the survivors of the St. Louis. I don't know if you're familiar with the St. Louis ship. Was sent back, America sent it back for the people to. First, they went to Cuba. They had visas to go to Cuba. And Cuba sent them away, these Jewish people looking for asylum. And then we sent them away, and then Canada sent them away. Well, anyway, we had a reconciliation with them down in Florida. And then we went to this Holocaust Museum, and as we walked in, there was all these black, like granite stones with photographs etched into them. And one of our girls started screaming and screaming, and we said, what's the matter? And she says, it's my uncle. He's alive. My uncle's alive. Oh.
Wow.
So David Shatner, the curator, came out, and he said, of course, he comes here all the time. So they made an arrangement for them to meet, and that was wonderful. So I told David, I said, I have a poem I wrote about the Holocaust. And he says, send me a copy. So I did, and I get back sort of a legal form, and he says he wants to put it on permanent display in the museum.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll be honored.
That's
honored. I had to sign it, and I said, boy, I'd be glad. So this Kathy's here, if anybody's interested.
Kathy, is that painting reflecting your poem?
No, this is, no, this one is in Bucharesti, in Romania. When we got there, there was all these little crosses and candles and things out in the streets. And they had just brought down Ceausescu. This was shortly after communism fell. And so I was taking photographs of them, and then my friends and I decided we would go to the museum. And when we got in the museum, they were making a big, big display to honor these people who died. And then we turn around, and there's the flag that they, the Romanian flag that they had cut the hammer and sickle out of, and went up against Ceausescu, and we just started to bawl. And I said, we got to get a picture of that. So they took my camera, so I had to go back to the desk and see if I could get my camera. And took a picture, and that's what this is. It's faded a little bit, but that's the Romanian flag. And I cut the where the hammer and sickle was. I put it over the cross to show faith conquers evil. Right? And that's what that's all about. And then when we went to Hong Kong, I took a picture in the synagogue of the Talit rack, and everybody likes that. I thought I had another picture with me, but I guess I didn't bring it. That was right next to the synagogue in Budapest is Theodor Herzl's house. And I had taken a photograph of the gate was closed and has a Star of David and had a lock on it. And somehow it just spoke to me that prophetically, you know. And then I go to hear, what's his name, Ted Pierce sing at, he's not here tonight. The fellow goes to Samantha's Little Bit of Heaven. He was singing there. And his son had a PowerPoint of pictures of Israel, and he has that picture from Hungary, the exact same picture, exactly. And so anyway, I get acquainted with Ted Pierce, and then they decided they were going to come and have a reconciliation of the Holocaust survivors from New York, and the German sons and daughters of Nazis were going to come and have a and they were going to do it in New York. And I said, well, what's the matter with Yaphank? He says, what's Yaphank? I said, Camp Siegfried. We had Nazi parades, Nazi everything out there. So he says, okay, give me the names of your pastors and the emails and the synagogues and the Messianic pastors, and we'll see what we can do. And we did on Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day, we had a march from where they used to come out from New York, from Madison Square Garden in New York to the railroad station, and then they would walk parade in uniform up to where the Historical Society is, where you had your show, and the water there. So they had all the chairs set up there. We had a very nice reconciliation. About 250 people showed up. So what I'm trying to say is, we never know where our art's going to take us. You know, we don't know. Like, look at Goya, he did Kings. And I want to show you this too. Now, I did a huge painting. Some of you have been to my house, have seen it, of Israel. And I did it in 1980, before I ever went to Israel. And my first trip to Israel, the painting is huge and it's pointless. It took me 3 months to paint. I can pass this around as long as you hold it by the cardboard. What's his name? Bill Grimanti was the one who did that beautiful Jean Clay.
Yes.
Yeah, he spent 2 hours just photographing it. He said he wanted to get even the shadow of the paint lumps, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's beautiful.
Yeah, so that was my first trip to Israel.
And the bus. This is what medium is this? Watercolor?
No, this is a cheap clay copy. It was a great big acrylic painting like these.
Oh, good.
But all little tiny. What I did was I was with Professor County at the time, and he suggested put your acrylic paints on a cardboard covered with the dull side of aluminum foil. Mm-hmm. Put your paints out there. Put your brush on a bamboo stick, on the end of a bamboo stick, and paint like that. Mix every little spot separately. And that's why it took me months to paint.
Wow.
Months. Yeah. But then, yeah, so then we, when we go to, we go, my first trip to Israel, the bus starts climbing. The bus is groaning and groaning, and it's starting to be sunset. And the girls are crying in the bus. And I said, what's the matter? They said, we're going up to Jerusalem. Because it's on a hill, and it's up, you know. And we went up the Mount of Olives. The bus turns around, and there's my view.
Yes.
Exactly.
Wow. And, so
I said to my roommate, I said, that's my painting. And she says, are you going to paint that? I said, no, I just did. Yeah, so that's some of the things that happened. You know what? I started out wondering. Here's a couple more from that series. I did so many. I did some on famine. And I use skulls. And when I first started, when I took drawing with Bob White, Christian White's father.
Oh yes, Robert White.
Robert White.
Yes.
I took drawing with him. He made me get a skull. I had to borrow a skull from Tracy County. And carried around a little box all the time, got me a seat on the bus every time. For months he had me do that skull upside down, backwards, every direction he could. But that helps you with doing portraits. Yeah. Yeah, it helps a lot, and to do the muscles too, to learn to do the muscles. So anyway, one of the other ones I did, I didn't bring it, was a print of the locust that I mentioned in Revelation. So these were my drawings for the locusts.
Mm-hmm. With the gas masks?
And with gas masks. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I went to the Army Navy stores and copied, circle stores and copied gas masks. So, and I did a lot on helmets and things like that too. And then my last painting I did in that whole series was I was cleaning up at the doctor's office where I worked, and I was looking through the magazines, and there was a picture of a tank with camouflage on it in the desert. And it said, that looks like a snake coiled, ready to strike. So that's what I did, a monoprint of that. And they put it in the president's office at Stony Brook. They gave me several great big shows while I was there.
Nice.
They even put me in the peace. Here, all my paintings are about war, and they put it in the Peace and Disarmament Center. Mm-hmm. Don't ask me why. and then they took some off to the island of St. Martin, and because they thought it was peaceful. Okay. and then when I graduated, they finally gave me a degree, got rid of me. I didn't want to leave. they gave me a one-person show at graduation, so
nice.
they treated me extremely well.
Wow.
It was very good.
Yeah.
Yeah. And anyway, that's what some of what I do. Oh, I'll pass this around if anybody wants to look at it. My flyer. This is Armine. Some of you girls know Armine. She's Mystery Babble and the Mother of Harlots, but she says, don't tell anybody.
Did she pose for you?
Huh?
Did she pose?
Oh, yes. Yeah. She's lovely. She's wonderful. No problem.
That's right.
And I was going to show you these first, but somehow I didn't. I'll go over some of these quickly. Like I said, I'm very eclectic. I don't stick to one thing like Ruth does watercolors. And I'm all over the map. And let's see. Okay, we went over those. Oh, this is when we came back from Russia. Mm-hmm. The Pen Women were having an art show on self-portraits. So this is my self-portrait. I have my grandfather's visa, so that's what these letters are. I have no idea what they mean in Russian.
Oh, okay.
And I put myself in one of the dolls. That's what that is.
What do they call those dolls?
Matryoshka.
Matryoshka.
Oh, and or nesting dolls.
Nesting dolls.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, I was going to start with this first. A lot of my paintings got wrecked in Sandy.
Yeah.
See how wrinkled that got?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I think you know this girl. Oh, and also I taught for BOCES for many years. Oh, here's some of the things I was looking for, you know. And I had the opportunity to sketch the kids, because a lot of times they would put me in computer class and the kids just sit there and work on the computer, and all I had to do was take attendance and sit there. So I would let the kids come one at a time, and they would sit and tell me their stories. And some of them never get a chance to talk to an adult. One kid was telling me that his mother lives in Virginia with her boyfriend, and the father lives out east with the girlfriend, and he lives alone, and he built a shelf over the door, and he keeps his pet snake there, so if anybody comes in the house, they'll drop on him.
Oh, nice.
How old is this boy?
Teenage.
Oh, a teenage.
Yeah. Oh, you know, I could tell, I could write a book about all the things that happened there, but we won't go, this is just a copy.
Oh, he looks like fun. Oh, I like
it. I did a lot of the mentally challenged children and gave them the pictures, and the teachers would put them up, and the kids just loved that, you know? And then I kept a lot of them myself, and the art teacher copied all of them. He loved them. He was copying everything he did.
He enjoys them wonderfully, your portraits.
And this boy here, I'm drawing him, and I see he's got a scar on his neck. So I said, that doesn't look like any thyroid surgery I ever saw. And he said, he's from the Viet Cong, tried to cut his head off.
Wow.
Oh,
that's what that scar was. Yeah.
When did you work there?
I worked there from 84 to 94, roughly.
Did you work over at Islip right here in Oakdale?
Yes, and Locust Avenue and Martha Avenue, and then once in a while they send me Stony Brook and Prem and a few other places.
Yeah,
yeah.
The same thing.
Yep.
They love it when you drop them.
Oh, and this was an etching I did at Suffolk County Community College. Mm-hmm. See, it's not mm-hmm. like the dry point,
where
it's done with the acid.
Hmm? Where did you
On a copper plate.
On a copper plate.
Copper plate, and then you put asphaltum over it, and then you scratch the needle, and then you put it in the acid. And this is a monoprint that's so successful that I did with Lester. Now this is supposed to be water lilies. So what do you do with an unsuccessful monoprint? I can use it as multimedia, built up some makeup, water lilies and put them on there. Or I can tear it up and use them in my collages. Mm-hmm. I love using this kind of thing in collage because it's good paper and it's oil-based ink. And this one's not oil-based ink, but most of them are oil-based ink, and they make a nice foundation. And I'll just show you a few of the portraits that I've done over the year. I'll try to do them quickly.
Eileen,
you probably know. This might have been done at Wet Paints.
Oh, over the head.
Yeah. This one, I won a first in Wet Paints centuries ago. And there's a bad mistake in it. I don't know if you can find the mistake.
The
hands, you got it. The hands are supposed to be the same size as the face. And they're not.
A little small.
They're too small, yeah.
Yep.
So I just brought a variety to see, you know, how you can make different. Not all of these are finished, but it gets interesting. Oh, I better hold them up.
It's very good.
I see. Some of these are the Tuesday group of South Bay.
Uh-huh.
And Bama's.
Are they watercolor?
Yeah. They're not, some of them aren't finished. Like this one's not finished.
They're watercolor, right?
Yes. And this one. Sally Pezza, she's running the Tuesday group now. And this one I did a long time ago. I brought it into Stony Brook.
Okay, nice.
And my black professor yelled at me. She said I had no right to paint blacks.
Really?
She was very sensitive.
I
love this one.
Yeah.
And this one's a different kind of paper, so it came out a little different.
Yeah.
Kind of different, like a blotter. It felt like a blotter.
Yeah.
All different kinds of people and faces. And this one I put a background on. After we saw that Wiley show, we saw this, I don't know if you're familiar with him, can't pronounce his first name, African first name, Wiley. It does life-size portraits that are out of this world. And he puts very, very detailed backgrounds. And they are, he does it all from photographs. He does photographs first. You know, he's a master photographer and a master painter. And he's down in Chelsea, if you ever want to go see Sam. Another lady. But I have so many of these, I don't know where to put them all. This guy had trouble staying awake. This one is Pete. I did a pastel of him, and I gave it to him. He has it, yeah.
Let's
and Joan Hickman,
I can't see him.
Oh.
The woman that is big.
Yeah.
This one, it might be Ann Wiswold, I'm not sure. Is that Ann?
Yeah.
Yeah. And this one's Joan, I'm quite sure. Joan Hickman. And this is Chris Taylor.
Oh, yeah.
And this is Chris Taylor.
Oh, that's very good.
And I have another one here of Chris Taylor. Only this one's.
She's in South Bay, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that one's passed out.
Yeah,
she was working with Luann at the Frank Framing Place. She's probably still there. Yeah, that's Chris. Some fellow I don't remember his name. I should write his names down. And the young man that never finished. What?
Kathy, did you ever do Lester?
What?
Did you ever paint Lester?
Yes, I did that. I gave him one that I did that was nice, and I did another one that's horrible. I still have it. It's horrible. I wouldn't show it to you. Another girl who sat for us. And he sat again today. He sat for us three times now. Yeah. Seamus.
Yeah. His beard has grown a little bit now.
Yeah. It did. It did grow.
It's down to here.
What was that instrument he had?
Banjo?
It was not a banjo. It's something else.
It's something that...
It looks like a combination of a guitar and banjo.
It was used before they made acoustic guitars.
Yeah. It's beautiful. It had a beautiful big sound. Very, very nice.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think that's about it.
Oh, you're not talking about your
collages.
These
two here.
That's right. Yes.
Okay.
Right. Well, I told you we went to Russia, Romania, Hungary, India, and China to speak to Jewish people about making Aliyah. And they have been gathering them from the nations. He's waking up people who don't even know, never knew they were Jewish, and they find out they're Jewish. Mm-hmm. We've met many people like this, Spanish especially. They start looking, doing their ancestry, and what do you know? Like one fellow, he said he never knew why his grandmother lit candles in the bathtub every Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So anyway, but they have not been gathered from America, God will. And it says in Hosea that the lion will roar from Jerusalem and they will come trembling from the west. And I think that the lion started roaring on 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
9/11.
Mm-hmm. Could you hold it up?
Oh, sure. I did this for Brookhaven Arts and Humanities.
Wow.
That said 9/11 remembered.
9/11, yes.
Yep.
That is something.
That's what that one is.
Could you tell about some of those little things you have in there?
Oh, that's, I do greeting cards also. And that's some of the crafty stuff. This is like mica.
No, the symbolic.
Money was, our money was shaken, remember?
Yeah.
Yeah, that we went into, and this is the cross that was left, remember?
Right.
Yeah.
And this very upset me. Well, my kids wanted to go down there over that Christmas. And I did not want to go. I just did not want to go. And they talked me into it. And there was a bicycle tied up there where the fellow never came out. And so that's the messenger boy, you know. So that's what that is. And that's one of the hijackers. And You have to read the book, The Harbinger, if you haven't read it, by Rabbi Jonathan Kahn, Messianic Rabbi Jonathan Kahn. He'll tell you what this is all about. And it's a harbinger, a sign of things to come, if we don't straighten up and fly right, you know? And the harbinger is what our president said, the head of the Speaker of the House. One after the other, they said the bricks have fallen down, but we will rebuild with hewn stones. The sycamores are cut down, but we will replace them with cedars. Isaiah 9:10. They said it over and over again, thinking they were saying something smart, but it's a curse. It's when Israel was in rebellion against God, and then they were destroyed. Israel was destroyed, and at the place where they were dedicated to God. And this is where Washington dedicated our country to God.
Yeah.
Was at that church right next door. And that church was not touched because a beam kept a tree kept the beam from falling down and hitting the church. So that church was not touched, and a lot of the people went in there. But then they planted a sycamore, and they said, just like they said, and it died. They said this was the tree of hope, and it died, and they had to take it away secretly and get another tree, you know? So it's a harbinger, and it's a warning. It's a warning to America, you know? It's serious. We're living in very serious times. It's scary. It really is, especially when we see what's happening in France and whatnot.
I like that.
You know? Yeah. So anyway, I do fun things too.
Kathy, can you turn that around, please?
Which one?
The one you
9/11.
Oh yeah, you have music on the back.
Yeah, I like that. That's great.
I hope it's a happy tune.
To get my brother to play it. And this, you're all familiar with.
Yes.
Yep.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, we love Fire Island.
We're used to those wispy clouds. Is that a collage?
That's fancy paper. Michael's just started. AC Moore just started bringing in some lazy papers, but that's just the lazy paper twine. And this is, you know, the stuff that you put under your rug to keep it from slipping.
Yes.
Well, I took pieces of that and just put them down and sprayed.
Wow.
Ink over it. Yeah. And that's other stuff that I'm a junk collector. It's terrible. My kids keep telling me how to move. I don't know how to move with all my stuff, but that's what I use. And speaking of junk collecting, every time I go to visit my girls, I head to Hobby Lobby, to Joanne's Fabric, not Joanne's, Mary Jo's Fabric Store. It's the size of a city. I get lost in there. And so anyway, I got this piece of mink at Mary Jo's cloth store some years ago and saved it.
Oh, that's terrific.
So I'm going to put that in this one is just shut.
I couldn't stop him in there.
Is he?
Huh?
I couldn't stop him in a lot of miles from the front.
You didn't put him in there, did you?
What?
The squirrel?
The squirrel?
Why? Is that a lie?
No.
Exactly.
It's just
the bird
tail.
The
chipmunk. Oh, it's
a chipmunk.
Squirrel.
Chipmunk.
Chipmunk.
Like your eyes. Yeah, they're little beads. Yeah. Oh, little gems.
Really nice.
Yeah, so I'm going to put this in this year's show. Yeah?
Good.
What is the medium?
This is all collage.
Okay.
All torn papers and junk.
Wow.
Collected junk.
And watercolors.
No, watercolors. No, just papers.
The eyes are
feathers. I got a feather in there.
What
are two
the
feathers.
Eyes
whatever.
What?
The eyes.
Those are little black gems.
That's nice. They really shine.
Yeah, because like I said, I do cards, reading cards, doing the embellishments, and so I use the stuff in here too. But that's I knew I'd use that piece of mink for something one day.
You save it long enough.
So there he is.
The color is so
perfect. Yeah, I feed them every morning.
That
they
like my cat's tail.
Could you pass that one around?
Well, I'll walk around.
What do you use the blue?
Oh, what?
When you use to glue it together?
You can use a neutral pH glue.
Well,
can you see that?
Sure.
Okay.
Easy.
Does it? Yeah.
I think that's it.
Were
these two fellows?
Yes. is it tenfold? What? I called him, he's a Christian narrator, but this is the thing. I made the Antichrist look like an ordinary God, because he's going to fool us.
What's the symbolism of the crown behind him?
Oh, that's Nebuchadnezzar's dream. His Nebuchadnezzar's vision. And you remember when Saddam Hussein rose to power, he thought he was the reincarnation of Nebuchadnezzar. Yes, he had big billboards all over Iraq. Nebuchadnezzar's vision and him.
Really?
He thought he was Nebi. Yes.
I love that little boy's face.
I have another half dozen sketches in that home.
Yes. Very good.
But they went through so much turmoil and now it's there again.
Do you usually
They're prayer shawls. Right. And they have the fringes coming down. So these are my fringes.
What does it say on there?
Another poem. Well, it's from the Bible. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. Otherwise, they will come and strike the land of complete destruction. Malachi 3:24. Then they wrote a little poem about it. Return to me with all your heart. Give wives and children a fresh start. Unite the family. Dry the tears. Close ranks. Hide in me. Fathers, gather your children. Let them run for cover. Fathers, lift your prayers, assemble your children, hide them under your wings, fold them in your talit, before the great and terrible day of the Lord, in quotes. Take shelter together from the storm. I will shake all nations until the desire of nations comes. I will shake heaven and earth until you say, Baruch Hashem, blessed be Adonai and Yeshua, the Son. Hallelujah. So that's what I do. I could say that my work has been like a double helix. Prophecy and portraits, and once in a while they intersect with paintings like this. That's it.